During the 1970s and 80s, Brummie headbangers Judas Priest established themselves worldwide as one of the most melodramatic and melodic of metal acts. And from their 1981 seventh studio album, Point of Entry, the track Hot Rockin'. One of the most powerful voices in all of rock, that got that great riff that started out kind of like just unaccompanied, and then that open cadence, like, and then finally we go into that more driving section, and let's see the what the lyrics are getting at. I've done my share of working out. I want to go someplace where I can scream and shout. Show me the lights where I can find the only thing I need to give me peace of mind. I want to go hot rocking. This could be like any like working person's clarion call, particularly in like the industrial workshops of Birmingham, where these musicians first came out of those neighborhoods and such, and a lot of the people they grew up with, it's wanting to waiting for that shift to be over where they can clock out and go hit the bars or whatever, or just go crank up their stereo. To say that he really managed to stretch some vowels quite effectively, particularly the word soar. Yeah, the couplet roar and soar, very characteristic, right? Just perfect, the embodiment of what he's projecting here. Where is the spark that kicks the air? Where is the energy that charges everywhere? Huh, the metaphors are getting a little bit more colorful here. I see the crowd, I hear the roar, I feel my body to leave the ground and soar. So talking about the kind of transcendent experience of rock and roll. Epic, like open cadence, Well, we've gone down. We've plunged like five keys, and it, like the opposite of a modulation. We're going like deeper, kind of into the. Oh, the sonic kind of like abyss here. We, plunging the fiery depths.
Yeah.
dig that tone, that kind of feedbacky tone, that, or that sustain, you know, that we were hearing toward the end there. Great solo in the middle there. Yeah, the guitar team of Glenn Tipton and KK Downing. Very effective chord structure, you know, working lots of like A minor, D minor. Yeah, these minor keys. As I was saying the other day, what I like about this kind of music is that it uses a lot of minor modality, and so there's more like melodrama. There's a bit more tonal possibility. I was commenting the other day about how punk, you don't really get minor modalities much because they're never playing full chords ever. They're playing just kind of like rock voicing, like tonic and fifth type, like two string or maybe three string type, like lower string type power chords. Yeah, and so you never get that like tension between major and minor modality in much punk, so you don't get as much melodrama. And that, but then again, there are many other reasons why, unless the band happens to have like a maximalist streak. Let's finish up the lyrics here. I'm going out in search of the bright lights. Somehow I feel that tonight is the right night. I'm almost there. I've got the vibration. It's coming strong from this generation. My blood is hot. From now on, I'm set free. My pulse is hot. So don't try to stop me, because this is it, and I'm hot rocking. Don't let it stop. Don't let it end. Please let it carry on and on and on and on again. I get so high, knocked off my feet. Yeah, this is the only way I want, I want, I want. I want to go hot rocking. It's all I want. It's all I crave. I just do want to go hot rocking. Bear in mind that these lyrics were written in a time when the only thing to really do on a weekend night was to go out. I mean, you would have gone, like today, people cocoon a lot, or they're on their their little itty bitty like palm things. Oh, these damn things! I barely even know how to use this damn thing, but back in those days, back in like 1980, 81, you would have gone insane just staying in on a weekend. I mean, there were only like about three channels on TV. I mean, heck, in the UK, I don't even think they had cable television. I mean, the thing to do was to go out and cruise and to go looking for fun, looking for action. It was before you had all these deadly diseases that sexually transmitted. It was before people had like a million things. It was before people could go on the internet and just be occupied for hours upon hours, you know, whether, no matter what you're into, whether it's just junk, being an info junkie on Wikipedia, whether it's just binge watching videos on YouTube, whether it's downloading MP3s, whether it's playing video games, whether it's, heck, if you wanted to play video games, you had to go to an arcade and save up your money and play at your own risk, because they often stole your quarter. Back in those days, it was all about, you know, hitting the town, and the biggest, it was kind of innocent too. I mean, because like the biggest concerns anyone had was like, a teenager had was if he or she could get the keys to the car or be allowed to take the car out, or whether they had to sneak out through their window. No one was all wrapped up about some of the more ridiculous things they're wrapped up about today. Anti-conceptual issues and such. Anyway, that was Hot Rockin' by Judas Priest. Very much a kind of fist-pumping, action-seeking anthem from a band that never lost touch with its like hometown roots, the kind of working-class vibe always kind of coming through in the lyrics, the attitude and such. Let's hear another track from this album, Point of Entry, the kind of Beatlesque track for them. Yeah, you probably know which one I'm getting at. You Say Yes. Up. Oh. this riff just kind of like shuffles the same. It stays in the same key center and just like changes like a note or two and just kind of like shuffles it around, kind of almost like kind of funky in its own way. Even if the band didn't really delve into the funkier side of hard rock, some of the acts from the same time period, the Ian Gillan band anyway. For a while there had been kind of, well, actually you can't really expect that from 1981. In the mid 70s, for a bit, there was kind of a marriage going on between funk and hard rock, and then the two streams of music kind of purity spiraled a bit more. Like the new wave of British heavy metal kind of stripped away some of the more looser, kind of let it all hang out elements out of metal and kind of streamlined, went less for kind of like a lumbering blues based type of approach that would have been more accepting of funk elements, and towards a more streamlined galloping approach which some could say was a byproduct of punk, and then of course funk went electric and streamlined and stripped down, but that's a different story for another video. Yeah. Okay, let's catch up with the lyrics here. So you want to rip it up, paint the town red, want to do the hot spots, get it in the head. You drive me crazy, I know your game. You've done it all before, you'll do it all again, huh? This one's not quite so obvious at first. I think it's just kind of about perhaps indecisiveness, about maybe finicky behavior from the person that he's with, maybe kind of irrationality. He's perhaps with someone who's does one thing and says another. Maybe, well, I don't want to speculate. Something comes to mind, but I'm not going to speculate. Bassy middle eight section, like laying those bass notes, those sustained bass, like letting them just play out. I like how it's rare to hear like a metal band kind of do a passage where less is more and let kind of atmosphere fill in the sonic framework a bit between the notes. Creative use of just kind of sustained chord, like single, like, you know, strum and then hold it and like breathing and almost in its own way. It's kind of like similar yet different to like, say, something, a passage that the Police might have in one of their songs, you know, where they just kind of do this kind of loose break or something. You. I love how they gradually building up. It's almost like they were kind of like down in the ditch in a way, and just kind of like climbing out of it, like gradually getting higher and higher and higher up. Judas Priest, You Say Yes. As I said at the beginning, kind of a Beatlesque type song for them. I'm thinking, well, the Beatles, of course, used that hook line in one of their songs. I'm thinking from the Magical Old Mystery Tour period, but I'm thinking more kind of like this invokes kind of like the 65 era Beatles, like early 1965 kind of. Kind of like the, somewhere between like the Hard Day's Night and Help period. And that's kind of like not an influence that creeps up a lot in this kind of music, even though most of the musicians would have grown up inspired by the Beatles. The reason for that being, heavy metal was very much an outgrowth of the blues rock boom of the late 1960s, which is what propelled rock from the flexible foundationalism of, say, mid-period Beatles to the full-blown maximalism that rock had evolved into by 1970 with the arrival of heavy metal, symphonic rock, and jazz rock. You know, expansive styles that expanded the range of like volume, instrumentation, soloing, the harmonic framework of rock became newly expanded, and melodrama, theatrical vocals, full range, kind of like operatic range singing at times, as opposed to the more kind of just kind of limited harmonic confines of like mid-60s rock. While the Beatles set the stage for maximalism, the development of metal kind of postdated them. And so the Beatles were just kind of like an early inspiration, but not an audible influence on metal per se, or those most closely associated with the genre, and especially not second generation metal acts, of which Priest could mostly be considered. I mean, Priest debuted in 1974, and they actually formed like, some of them were playing together as early as 71, but let's face it, they didn't really get off the ground and get before the people really until like around, just before the new wave of British heavy metal took off. And so they're kind of more closely associated with that than they are with like Sabbath, the Purple, the first line. So it's kind of rare to hear kind of like a Fab Four influence kind of resurface in this music, and yet it works. And I just love I love that just because what you have in this song is you have you have that kind of hook laden aspect of like a 65 era Beatles track, but it's brimming with kind of like a rage that the Beatles themselves never approached. I mean, every other word, like Rob Halford is just like kind of like flaring up, like, well, and kind of, in that sense, kind of a product of its time, too, because there were quite a few singers that were approaching that kind of, where a line might begin somewhat, at least kind of mannered to a degree, and then flare up by the final vowel of each line. He could sound pretty aggressive all the way through. I'm thinking there were other singers from like this time period, like Joe Jackson on Be Crazy, which came out just right before Point of Entry, have deserved that. He would always like flare up at the end of each line, like and or like Phil Collins did that. I mean, it crossed several different. It was kind of in all corners of music at this point. You could say that more kind of like rage, that kind of seething quality that was just ready to like burst out of the operative words of a particular line. Yeah. Judas Priest, You Say Yes, from the album Point of Entry, released in 1981, and before that, Hot Rockin'. Yeah, two great songs off an album that saw them expanding their appeal, particularly in the United States, and like with a big crossover hit, Heading to the Highway, kind of a libertarian anthem. And yeah, their seventh studio album, not necessarily their best album front to back, but a few really great highlights that have stood among their best. Their best albums overall, like front as far as like front to back quality goes, arguably would be Sin After Sin, Stained Class, Screaming for Vengeance, and Painkiller. But those are all for different installments. Anyway, for more Rubies and Sapphires from the catalog of Judas Priest, see the directory of albums by English J artists, linked in the description below, for Red Hot Tracks and Tasty Purples from this album, the six studio albums before it, and three of the studio albums after it, as well as many other J artists. From both solo performers and bands from England from between, say, like the late 60s and mid-1980s. Like and subscribe and follow me on social media and leave a comment if there are any observations you have about these two tracks, the riffage, the soloing, the lyrics, and I guess most importantly, the vocal performance of Rob Halford and the emotion, and the expression, and the rage, and just the whole overall vibe that he put across and how he conveyed it and how it might resonate with you. And until next time, this is Zaragon, the world's most air travel trad excellence, signing off.